Okay, thank you, Malik, for the invitation, and I'm really impressed that you've given us this lovely evening, because I know how much we do this evening is in my garden with a nice cold drink or something of that nature. So I'm really pleased that you are here. You can all hear me?
Yes.
Yeah? Okay. So Malik has asked me to talk about spirituality and mental health. I've added a bit of religiosity in there, and I'll explain a little bit about that. So what I want to do in this presentation is just do a couple of definitions so that we have an understanding of what these concepts mean. Also to say that this lecture builds on what Suman talked about, because I think in his lecture he talked about how different religions deal with mental health and mental illness. I'm not going to go over that ground. But I'll talk a bit about definitions. Then I want to look at religiosity and spirituality as protective factors for mental health, for mental well-being. But I would also talk about religiosity and spirituality as risk factors for mental health. Then I will briefly look at how psychiatry has responded to religion and spirituality. And then finally, we'll talking through a model of what is called spiritual care and some pointers for how that can be done. Also, Malik said I should talk for 30 minutes. I tried and did my research, and there's a lot written about mental health. There's a lot written about religion. There's a lot written about spirituality. And the three together has got very scant literature. You probably would be surprised, or perhaps not surprised, that of all our psychiatry textbooks, any psychiatrists here? Guess how many of the plethora of psychiatry textbooks we have in the UK have a chapter on spirituality, religion, and mental health? One. So that leaves us with a very, what I would call a very weak starting point in terms of how we deal about these issues. And I also want to acknowledge that it's actually quite poignant that today we talk about spirituality, religiosity, and mental health, given what happened last night. And, it's quite poignant that we are in this moment where these sort of things are happening.
Yeah.
So before I'm going to kick off, I wondered, I know we're going to have time to talk afterwards, but I just want to get a quick sense of why did you come and listen to this talk? Because I'm not sure you wanted to come and listen to me. Anybody want to lecture? Otherwise, I'm going to point. I'm good at pointing.
To learn about I come from a Christian background, and I came from a white Christian background, to learn more broadly about other faiths and other
okay. Anybody else? This time?
We go visiting Springfield, which is a large campus in the same area. And we are often asked questions about religion, or when people were having trouble with religion. And so we wanted to hear what somebody said about it.
Anybody else?
Yes.
Because I'm very interested in your work anyway, and I'm really interested in terms of the ways in which you're going to bring those together, because I too have some ideas around spirituality, particularly as a protective factor, and also as a potentially risk factor.
Yes.
So I'm just really interested in what you're going to say.
Okay. So let me move on, and I'll talk about the context. And first of all, these are complex sets of ideas in our contemporary society. And I think two reasons why I'm saying this is we currently live in a fairly secular world where materialistic values, humanism, all those things are creeping in, and there's certain terms we can't use anymore. We can't say Christmas anymore. Yeah? We have to say happy holidays. Yeah? According to the papers, but even Christmas cards, you know. So some of these things are written out of our historical narrative and all those things. So I think because we are in the secular world, it is sometimes difficult for us, and your question about how to talk to people about spirituality and religion, because we don't have these conversations in our everyday life. So it's a conversation that we don't have. And I will show you why it's important we need to have this conversation. So it's that. But also I think this is informed by what is called the mind-body dualism. And this was an idea by Descartes, who was a philosopher, who argued that the mind and the body are two distinct things. They are two distinct entities, and therefore, that there's some interaction between these entities, but they aren't distinct. And I think I'm hoping those who came to Suman's lecture, I hope that those of you who came to Suman's lecture would have heard him talking about how this duality, the splitting of the mind and the body, has informed mental health treatment. And that mental health treatment thinks they can treat the mind the same way we treat the body. And so that's our other difficulty. So this is what, whoops. No. Didn't mean to go there, that's where I want to go. So this is the mind and the body dualism. So the mind consists of the spiritual essence. And so spirituality here involves the ephemeral. And then at the other extreme where people vilify spirituality, they say it's wishful thinking, people are living in a false world, people are living in a world that doesn't really exist, because, what is this is our body. You know, we know that there's a physical essence to our bodies, there's a physical presence, and that's real, and that is what we need to be looking at. And so this dualism, I think, has had a significant impact on how we think around mental health, religiosity, and spirituality. Now, I see if I can get back to my other slide. Sorry, I was trying to. Okay, I'll just do this. Okay. So there is a relationship between religion and science. Science, on the one hand, says it's about what we can observe, what we can count, what we can feel, what we can see. So it's about empiricism. And religion is about these things that we can't touch, you know, these transcendental things. And so there is also this divide. So we've got the divide between the mind and the body, but we've also got the divide between science and religion. And actually, it goes against the grain of science, because you probably won't be surprised if you know that one of the key founders of the scientific religion was actually a friar. He was a monk, I think, the Franciscan order. So science, the pioneers of science, were religious people. There were people from all sorts of faiths, from Buddhism, from Islam, from all those things, and yet we find ourselves now in a world where these two things are separate, these two things are seen as distinct. And then, of course, and the next bit is how we construe mental ill health. Mental ill health. It's a contested term. And I've always argued when we talk mental health, we talk mental illness. We don't really talk mental health. We don't really know what mental health is. And so that also makes it difficult for us to bring this spirituality and religion, which is on, you know, transcendental, ephemeral, to bring these things into a conversation around mental ill health. So I'm putting it like that because I haven't come to a term. I have recently tried. I was asked to write a paper about madness and blasphemous, and I struggled with the terminology because it's not what we use here. It's what people use in Canada, in Australia, in parts of North America. We still talk mental health here, so that was quite a difficult conversation to have. But also, we have a technical revolution. So social media is just ruling our lives. And what do you think that does to us? Our ways of communication has changed dramatically. And people talk less to each other face to face. And so what's happened here is that the transcendental, the ephemeral, those things have gone. Because now on Facebook you can say anything. People say everything they want to on social media because, you know, we haven't got that barrier of the transcendental, of the ephemeral, of the spiritual. And so that leaves us, I would argue, with something of quite a void here. And so for me, as somebody who writes about mental health and talking to people in my research around these sort of issues, I am concerned that we need to bring spirituality and religiosity back to the table. Is it this one here?
We're just going to switch it up.
I'll put it over there. Okay. So let me just quickly define religiosity. So religiosity is defined as behaviors and beliefs that are associated with organized religion. So there's both an individual dimension to it, but there's also an institutional dimension to it. So in the, I don't know the exact figures, but in the latest Office of National Statistics, people were asked, how do you find yourself? And some people may say, I'm Christian. And then they would be asked, so how often do you go to church? And then they may say, 3 times a year, Christmas, Easter, family, deaths, and births. So there are two dimensions to religiosity. It's the individual dimension, so this is about people's religious beliefs. It's about their religious practice, their knowledge about religion. But then it also has this institutional dimension, so it's about religious practice, their religious experiences, but also the effects that religion may have on them. So that's, and I'll give you the references hopefully will be on the website if you want to read that. So spirituality is the one I'm sure you all want to hear about, so I'm going to talk about that now. So spirituality contains the following. First of all, it is the belief and obedience. Now obedience I should probably put into inverted commas here, but it's a belief and obedience to a powerful and supernatural force. So it's about accepting or acknowledging that there's something out there. We don't really know what it is. We don't really know what it looks like. We don't know whether it has a gender. We don't know whether it has an ethnicity. We don't know what it is. But generally people, if they're not agnostics, if they are atheists, they believe. Something. I've always argued, atheists also believe in something. You can't say you believe in nothing. You have to believe in something. So that's the first thing about spirituality. And it involves the ways in which people fulfill what they hold to be the purpose of their life. So spirituality is how we live our lives. Thirdly, and it includes a search for meaning of life.
So what sense do we make of the world? So what sense do we make of what happened last night in Manchester?
You know, everywhere I went today, people were asking about that. People were talking about that. It's the, you know, because we're trying to make sense of our world, what is happening to our world. And also, okay, it's a sense of connectedness to the universe. And so it's our sense of connectedness to places, to people, to spaces, and our sense of connectedness to time. And I think oftentimes, our sense of connectedness to time, and that goes back to my technological revolution, our sense of connectedness to time gets undercut by some of these things. Because I grew up in South Africa, I've now lived in this country for 30 years, but I still have a sense of my time there. And that sense of time still gives me strength, gives me a resource, gives me a coping mechanism, but it's some of these other things that comes and cuts across those sort of things means that we lose our sense of time. And here I'm talking about historical time and the present time, but also the future. So that's spirituality. Now if you look at that, do you think we all have it? I would. Aren't you all seeking for the meaning of life? Aren't you all seeking to live out the purpose of your life? So I wonder why in mental health this is not important. Because people are trying to make sense of their life. They are trying to find out what the purpose of their life is. And they also want to be connected to other people. Nobody wants to be disconnected. Nobody wants to be isolated. So I think really we all have spirituality. Whether we accept it, whether we believe it, but I think we all have something that is part of our humanity. Animals don't have it. Animals don't worry about the meaning of life. Animals aren't not looking for the purpose of life. We are. So I would argue. Spirituality is essential, and I would say further, essential to our mental health. Okay? So now let's look at spirituality and religiosity as protective to mental health. So, as something that supports emotional well-being. So the first one, research evidence has shown that spirituality and religiosity can help people to cope with adversity, including poverty, illness, physical ill health, and I would say mental ill health as well. You know, that people can find a source of strength in that adversity. But also, I'm probably focusing on religiosity, because talking about the institutional dimension, for organized religion or faith, whatever term you want to use, it gives people access to social support. There's just many people who find, sometimes for them, going to a church on a Sunday morning is the highlight of the week. For somebody to go to the mosque and prayers on a Friday is the highlight of the week, because there's talk, there's something. I've sometimes seen the local mosque in my area Friday afternoons. People go leave the mosque. They're all there because it's a network, it's social, and likewise in churches and in other places. So, religion, and also it counters us as being isolated, and it counters social exclusion. It's about being inclusive. And this is an interesting finding, that religious people live longer. I don't know how much longer. But it's certainly a finding from research that says that religious people actually do the work. You know, so they are advantages. But also, religious involvement is associated with pro-social values. Doing good unto others, being respectful unto others, valuing others. And so why, if religion encourages pro-social values, why is it not such a key part of our discourse about mental health? You know, because mental health, for me, should be about promoting pro-social values. Values that's about sharing, respect, dignity, honesty, openness, all those things should be in there. And it's also, finally, a protective factor against emotional distress. And it's a factor, again, because of both the intrinsic value of it, but also the extrinsic. So going to meetings, going to meet other people, all those things can help you to overcome your stress, distress. Unfortunately, there's more slides to the risk factors, and I don't know why. So I'm going to look at those. So again, the research evidence shows that a lack of spirituality can lead to emotional distress. So if people do not have a sense of their purpose in life, if people do not have a sense of the meaning that life has for them, if people do not have a sense of connectedness with other people, then that can lead to their developing emotional distress. So there's a very clear link here between the two. But also, a loss of interest in religious activity can also be a sign of depression. And this is particularly pertinent for any mental health practitioners who are here. Are there mental health practitioners here? People working in mental health? Yeah? So when you work with people and you know that they are spiritual or religious, one key way of monitoring their mental well-being is not just saying, have you taken your pills, but it's actually saying, when last have you been to the mosque? When last have you been to the temple? When last have you been to church? And if we notice that that is going down, then we can also notice that they are leading to a breakdown. So it's really important marker for how we can help people maintain their emotional well-being. Yeah. And we can talk about this later. And of course, spirituality and religiosity can lead to suicidal ideation. So when people feel, oh, I don't know what life is about, or life has no meaning for me, I have no purpose in life, that's when people want to commit suicide. And we also know that suicide is a national issue in this country. The government had wanted to bring down suicide, particularly for young men. They wanted to bring it down by 2012, then they didn't meet their target, and now they say 2020, and 2020 is nearly by the door. We'll see what they do then. You know? And I don't think that we can address the high rate of suicide by, and I'm not saying that suddenly people should go to church and go to mosque and do all those things. What I'm saying is that if we can help people to express their spirituality, that could be a protective factor. And it's something that I would like us to consider. So next slide. So of course, spirituality, but probably more religiosity here is at play. People can deny that there's something wrong with them, because they say it's the will of God, it's the will of Allah. You know, I'm being punished And so therefore I don't really need treatment, I don't need to seek help, I don't need to speak to others. So that's a negative thing. But it's also a demonization of symptoms. You know, in some of our very evangelical churches, I have nothing against them, I grew up in one in South Africa, you know, that we demonize mental health. It's spirit possession, it's evil, it's all those sort of things, and therefore people don't get the appropriate help or the appropriate support that they need. And it's also about misconstruing religious states and experiences. And so it's how we are open to people's religious experiences and their religious states or their spiritual states. Because look at this quote from somebody who says, "When I speak to God, they say I pray. When I say I heard the voice of God, they say I'm mentally ill." Have we come across that?
Yes.
And I think that is where we misconstrue people's spiritual and their religious experiences. So really, when we talk to people, it's about really finding out what that experience means for them. And is it so bad that God talks to somebody? Is it? It's not. So why does it become mental illness when somebody says, "I hear the Lord speaking to me"? So it's about how we should not misconstrue religious states and experiences. So one more on this. But it's also sometimes religiosity and spirituality can lead to what's called a distortion of normative religious beliefs. So when people start thinking they have special powers and they can do things outside of in ordinary human power, so that can be dangerous and damaging to their mental health. And also stressful events can transform normative religious beliefs into excessive preoccupations. You know, so people can have these suicidal ideas, they can have a sense of self-guilt, of self-blame, of worthlessness, all those sort of things. So again, it's about having that balance here. But it can also encourage physical abuse and we've seen cases where children died as a result of the physical abuse. I think we're all probably familiar with the Columbia case, which I think was based on this little extract from Proverbs, which says, "Withhold not correction from the child." And one of my students has done a piece of work on what she called chastisement in particular communities. And even though hitting a child, powerful things, is against the law, but it happens in communities, especially when we leave, you know, that it is still okay to physically abuse children. And that comes from a religious base, comes from a cultural base, and so it's how we work with that. So, Malik, how am I doing for time?
Okay.
You sure?
Yeah, another 10 minutes or so.
Okay. I won't be that long, I hope. So just very briefly, psychiatry, religion, spirituality, and I've already said about the text. So this is a survey done asking psychiatrists about their religious affiliations. And 73% reported no religious affiliation. You see there's a mistake there, I didn't know how that three got there. So 28% reported a belief in God. And only 31% asks their patients about religious practice. Now, we recall those of you who work in psychiatric care, when people admit it, we ask them, what's their religious affiliation? Don't we? I think it's recorded. Should be. And yet, in practice, people don't ask him about it. And this is what Servetus, on the other hand, says. A significant number of service users report belief in a god. Now that is so important for service users, and what are we as mental health practitioners doing with that? What are we mental health doing? So it's really, but that's just, I can talk a lot about this, but I won't. So I'm getting sort of, so meeting spiritual needs. And these things look common sense, but they don't happen. And so I'm saying it again. I think it's really what we need to do when we work with people is finding out what does spirituality mean for them. Because spirituality has a different meaning for all of us. And so our meanings aren't the same, but it's important that we find that out. Find out what role does spirituality and religion play in their life. And also, would they like to talk to someone about spiritual or religious matters? Because if we don't ask those questions, people will not feel comfortable to raise them with us. And so it's really important that we make it open for these things to be talked about. And then, so before I end, just presenting a model of spiritual care that there's a reference by Delgado, and she's a nurse, but she's developed a really nice framework for thinking about providing spiritual care. And she says, we need to start with these three interconnected things. We need to accept that the mind, body and spirit are totally interconnected, intertwined, and we need to challenge the body-mind dualism. And she says, if we want to provide spiritual care, then we need to accept these three things are intertwined. And she gives some ideas as to what we can do in our practice. So she says, when we assess people, there are things we can do. So it's asking about questions about faith, asking questions about religious practices, asking questions about symbols, all those sort of things. And probe meanings for the service user. But also, she clearly argues that we should distinguish religious spiritual needs from needs for what's called somatic care, also need for medication and those sort of things. You know, we're not saying one is preferable over the other. We're saying that meet spiritual needs, but also meet the other needs from that. But also, and then she's also saying communication, how we communicate about needs are important. So it's listening carefully. It's focusing on the person's worldview and listening for their worldview, because remember we said spirituality is about meaning of life, seeking our purpose in life. So it's about helping, finding out from people in our communication with them what this all means for them. And then support, it's about supporting them emotionally, it's supporting them to have conversations around religiosity and spirituality. And what she argues, you can't do this if you have no presence. And I think sometimes in mental health, we get so pressurized, and we get so busy, and I'll come and see you tomorrow. And so we cannot deal with spiritual care or meet people's spiritual needs if we don't have presence with them. And presence with people means making time for them, sitting with them, means knowing something that we can't hold people's hands and all those sort of things because of the risk averse culture, but it's about this time with people about that. So that's a sort of model of spiritual care which I hope we can again talk about. So I think, yes, so I hope what I've done is just whisk you through these definitions, but then look at religiosity and spirituality as protective factors for mental health, but also looking at them as risk factors and then some pointers as to how we can work on some of these. these ideas. And so I conclude. So I would conclude that religiosity and spirituality are important dimensions in the lives of individuals and should not be ignored. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
One thing we know at the Community Empowerment Network, many of you may know, the Community Empowerment Network is a network of around about 45 community and voluntary sector organizations. The vast majority of our members are from our local mosque, our local churches, our local temples. And what's really interesting about the work that we do is nearly everybody in our network. So you're talking about 45 organizations, you're probably talking about around 150, 200 people. Most of them are people who have a faith. Most of them are people who belong to an organized faith. All of them have a sense of spirituality and call on a spiritual sense of presence. And what's very interesting is that when we then speak to all of our many, many colleagues inside our public institutions, we do a lot of work at Southwest London and St. George's, is that the conversations around faith and spirituality are still very much a other conversation. It's never a core conversation. And I find that dichotomy between what our daily lives are within the network, within our communities, within all our interactions is so embedded in faith and spirituality, yet our public institutions are so remote from even beginning to have a conversation around faith and spirituality. And I think these are some of the things that Frank is very much touched on here. So we've got a few moments to have some conversations and some questions. I know some people wanted to ask questions. So shall we shoot for some questions? Edward.
Thank you very much for your talk. Just two observations. I don't know what you said.